Recorded Books and RB Digital present Bobby Sky, Boy Band or Die by Joe Shine. Narrated by Christopher Carley. Chapter 1. Only Faking. Jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, I get how weird it is to be quietly singing Christmas songs to myself right now. Believe you me, I do. But I dare you, no, I challenge you to think about Christmas and not have a carol or seven pop into your head. It's impossible. Christmas songs are like potato chips. You're gonna need more than one. In a one-horse open sleigh, hey! Funny thing is, it's not even the holidays right now. I had a random thought about what Christmas might be like here, and the dang things popped into my head. That's how powerful those songs are. Right now it's April, I think, and I'm straitjacketed up in a padded room pretending to be crazy. Bonus, though, quietly singing carols to myself only adds to this stellar performance. There should be Oscars for acting in real life. I would totally be nominated for this. Why am I pretending to be crazy? Why am I so nonchalant about being locked up against my will? Why am I laughing inside through daily beatings? Why am I not at all worried that I haven't had anything to eat or drink in days and I'm slowly dying? It's because I did it. I fulfilled the sole purpose of my life. Death? Cool with me. It's okay if my story ends here. Heck, maybe it's supposed to. It has been a ride, I'll give you that. I was betrayed, heartbroken, shot, stabbed, and run over. And that was just during my first year in the program. That's not even the good stuff. How do plane crashes, death squads, car chases, and the Yakuza sound? Are you interested? If not, you need to seriously reevaluate what you're looking for in your entertainment needs, because that stuff should raise the eyebrow of a hairless cat. It's a pretty long story, and if I had to guess, it'll take a good, I don't know, 10 hours or so to tell? I'm not going anywhere, obviously. You got the spare time? Fair enough. Let's do this. I guess we could start with the first time I heard Jingle Bells, since that would sort of bring this rambling introduction full circle. But I have no idea when that was. I was 4, maybe? Who knows? Doesn't matter. No, we'll start with the last time I was arrested, which ironically was during the holiday. Take that, random Jingle Bells intro. I was barely 14. I thought it would be like every other time I'd been cuffed, booked, and sent off to juvie. It wasn't. Oh boy, it wasn't. So, are you ready for a trip down memory lane? Good, because singing to myself and drooling on the plastic mats in here gets old pretty quick. Speaking of which, I should probably let out a good stream of craziness. I can't let my captors realize I'm faking it. That would really screw everything up. Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle bells. Okay, that should buy us some time. I don't think I'm due for any more torture sessions for a while. Chapter 2. Time to Pay the Fiddler. Just open up, okay? The voice was friendly but commanding. A cop's voice usually is, at least the cops I knew. This particular voice belonged to Officer Willis. I'd put all my weight and strength into keeping the door shut. I was pretty big for a 14-year-old, already close to 6 feet. My muscles were getting thicker by the day, thanks to weights and the demands of Texas football. I knew I couldn't stop them from coming in, but doing nothing seemed like giving up, which I'd never been good at. Like my dad always said, give it all you got until you can't give any more, and then try again to make sure you're really done. He drilled that into my head since birth. I'm not coming out, I yelled. My trademark shoulder-length hair had fallen over my eyes, so I shoved a greasy clump behind my ears.
Open the damn door, Hutch.
A different voice this time. Officer Ramirez. The other voice. They were a team. I decided when I was 5 that Bobby was a stupid kid's name, and Robert was an old man's name. I'd wanted no part of either. With my last name being Hutchinson, I had insisted on being called Hutch. It had stuck. one of the few victories in my life. Never! I yelled back playfully, but totally serious, too. Opening the door wasn't going to happen. They'd have to kick it in. Keeping my shoulder pressed hard into the door, I took a look through the peephole. No surprise, Officers Willis and Ramirez were smirking at each other. They shook their heads as if they had better things to do than hang out on the rotting deck outside the small apartment I shared with my mother. I agree that they probably did. The home, if you can even call it that, sat above the landlord's garage, and this door was the only way in or out. The two officers had been dealing with me off and on since I was a little kid. It was mostly petty crimes, fights, that sort of thing, so we all knew each other pretty well. They were pretty relaxed. You got nothing on me, I yelled, still watching. Officer Ramirez pulled out a notepad.
Grand Theft Auto.
The keys were in the car, and I brought it back when I was done. If anything, that's just grand borrowing. Oh, and ungrateful. I changed the oil for them.
The officers shared a grin. They were on one side of the game, and I was on the other. We both enjoyed playing it to its fullest.
Armed robbery.
I smiled and joked.
Can you be more specific? Russ's convenience store?
That? Come on.
He wouldn't sell me beer.
'Cause you're only 14.
I'm almost 15, I corrected them. But anyway, I paid for it, so it's not robbery.
You were brandishing a weapon.
That's just armed shopping then. I never pointed it at him. He just assumed I was going to. I have the right to bear arms. Are you trying to deny me my constitutional rights?
Still keeping my weight up against the door, I kept watching through the peephole as the officers exchanged a glance. Officer Willis nodded to Ramirez.
Aggravated assault.
I paused. I didn't have a smart-ass answer to that one.
He was hitting his 4-year-old with a baseball bat. I took it and hit him back with it.
Not saying we disagree, but it's not your place, Hutch. You know that. You nearly killed the guy. It's time to man up. Now open the door.
I liked Officers Willis and Ramirez. They were actually pretty cool guys. None of it was personal, and they tried to help me out of jams when they could. You couldn't call them friends. They were the fuzz. But they were nice to me when they could be. I put my back to the door again. From the stereo, I could hear the faint singing of Christmas music. My mother was a nutter for holiday tunes. She'd bought one of those monster Christmas song collections you see on the infomercials at 2 a.m. I knew every carol and song upward and backward. Publicly, I'd say I hated them all, but privately, I loved them. Who doesn't, really? It gave me an idea. We all knew how this ended, but they were going to have to earn it, and I was going to have some fun with them while they did.
Guys, come on. This isn't very festive of you. It's the holidays, I called out.
It's December 1st, Officer Willis responded. Our lights are up.
Your lights haven't been taken down in years, Hutch.
December's the holidays, I sort of yelled before calming down and adding, which is why I have a proposal.
Hutch, we don't have time for this, Officer Ramirez groaned.
Hear me out, and yes, you do. You join me in a festive carol, and I'll come out.
I waited for a response, but when I didn't get one, I decided to go for it and began to sing.
Deck the halls with bells of holly.
I waited for them to join in. Seriously, who can resist a fa-la-la-la-la, la-la-la-la?
People were running from the street to yell that one out.
Apparently, these coppers were the minority since I got nada. I tried again.
Deck the halls with bells of holly.
I waited again for them to join in, but still got only crickets. I was about to try a third time when I heard,
fa-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la.
I peeked out the peephole and saw Officer Ramirez shaking his head at Officer Willis, who shrugged.
Yeah! I couldn't help but yell out. Willie boy's a bass! Didn't see that coming. Not bad, man. Okay. You ready?
Ram Jam, you gotta join in too. That's the deal. Come on. I cleared my throat before going on.
'Tis the season to be jolly. Oh, la 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 la. They both sang out loudly and then together.
Don we now our gay apparel, fa la 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 la. Troll the ancient Yuletide carol, fa la 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 la.
I peeked through the hole and saw them both smiling. That's the spirit, boys! I yelled.
You do realize it's boughs of holly, not bells of holly, right? Officer Ramirez called out.
Best to end this Christmas sing-along. I bolted toward the living room window. I was halfway out when Officer Willis's size 12s kicked the door open. I smiled and gave them a mocking, Merry Christmas, boys! Before swinging my other leg over and going into free fall, then landing in the thick shrubs one story below. It hurt, but I'd done it before. I rolled out and sprinted across the yard. They'd never be able to catch me in a foot race. I was younger, in better shape, and this was my home, so I knew every back alley and shortcut for blocks in every direction. I would lose them easily. I hopped over my back fence into the neighbor's yard, jetted out to their front yard, and crossed the street toward the next house. I kept on cutting through lawns and hopping over fences as I went. A few streets away, a massive 8-foot wooden fence was staring me down, separating whatever house I was currently in the backyard of from the next. I scaled it easily, but only when I reached the top did I see the row of rose bushes on the other side. I tried to stop, but my momentum was too much and I fell headfirst into them. I popped up out of the shrubs, my entire body cut and stinging from the nasty thorns. A shocked housewife stared open-mouthed 10 feet away with her pruning shears. Ma'am? I said as I pulled a thorn out of my forehead. I ran across her backyard and out onto the front lawn. There were some sirens in the distance, but everything around here looked quiet. I stopped running, covered my face with my hair, and casually started to cross the street to the train tracks like any normal guy out for a walk. The plan was to get on the tracks and use them to avoid the roads for a bit. I'd made it halfway down a back alley when the jarring, terrified shriek of a child stopped me dead in my tracks.
Jesse, no! Help!
The voice screamed out. I didn't have time for this. I tried to convince myself it was nothing. This lull in the chase wouldn't last much longer, so I had to keep going. Kids screamed all the time about stupid stuff, right? I didn't need to worry about it. Or it was a crazy person who sounded like a kid. This area was full of them. Yeah, that's all it was. I began to step forward when...
Help! Help! Someone help!
The kid screamed again. The panic sounded genuine. Something bad had happened. I growled in frustration. Hating myself, I turned and sprinted toward the cries. A small girl appeared out of a backyard and flagged me down. Is everything okay? I asked her.
It's Jesse. He's hurt real bad.
She turned and ran back into her backyard. I knew I shouldn't do this, but I followed her into the backyard, where she fell to her knees in front of a flower bed and started sobbing. Once I slid to the ground next to her, I saw her clutching a small, dead frog in her tiny hands. You kidding me?
I stepped on him,
she admitted.
I think he's hurt,
she said, sniffling.
Hurt? Oh, he's dead, kiddo.
I was ready to get up and walk away when she held the sad, limp body of the little frog up to me and stuttered out,
Can you please help?
Ugh, why did she have to be so damn adorable? Yeah. Let me see, I said, reaching out for the frog and taking it from her. What the heck was I supposed to do with this slimy thing? You know, let me take it to my, vet friend. Yeah, and I'll see what he can do. Through her tears, the girl suddenly had a sliver of hope and asked,
Really?
Yeah, he saves frogs all the time, I lied. I'm sure he'll be able to save little Jesse here.
You think?
Yeah, totally. But you might not see Jesse again, I added as I got an idea.
Why not?
Well, My vet friend, you see, lives in a swamp, and Jesse may want to stay there because it's awesome. It'll be up to him, and I'll bet he'll want to stay and play around with all the other frogs that live there. You do want him to be happy, right? She nodded. The squawk of a patrol car in the distance brought me back to the reality at hand. Okay, well, I gotta get Jesse here to the vet now before it's too late, okay?
Okay, goodbye, Jesse, enjoy the swamp,
she called out to me as I walked away. Once I ditched the dead frog, I headed to Zilker Park, my go-to hideout from the Popo, which was only a mile or so away. I would wait there until a plan emerged, take a dip in Barton Creek, maybe. My phone rang. Mom. I ignored it. I was supposed to be in school, and answering your phone there was a big no-no. If I answered, she'd know I wasn't there. The call was immediately followed up by a text that simply read, "No, you're not in school. Call me. Now." Crap.
Hey, Ma. What's up?
I said, whispering like I was in class.
Where are you?
She asked flatly. So she knew I wasn't in school, didn't she? Or was this a test? You never know with parents.
School.
I lied.
School?
She repeated coldly.
Yep. Filling my head with some book learning.
I added lightly.
Math is awesome.
Come home right now.
The line went dead. I most definitely didn't want to do that. In fact, it was so far down my list of things to do, you could say it wasn't even on the list. I wanted to run and hide, but disobey a direct command from Mom? I had 50 pounds and nearly a foot on her, but do I dare go against the Supreme Commander like that? I was stupid, yes. Reckless, of course. But I wasn't crazy. I had no choice. Home it was. The walk home was awful. Nothing quite like knowingly walking toward impending doom. And the adrenaline had worn off long ago, so I felt miserable in the winter cold in only my t-shirt and jeans. When I rounded the corner onto my road and saw the police cruiser parked out in front of my house, I paused. For a moment, I considered turning around, but where would I go? I mean, what was my long-term plan here, really? Be a hobo in Zilker Park? Yes, I was a bad kid on paper and played the part well. But that wasn't really me. As I passed the neighbor's crumbling red brick house, I could hear voices talking, voices I recognized. I felt sick with guilt. Waiting for me in the driveway, right next to the rickety wooden stairs that led up to our tiny apartment, was my mother. Officers Ramirez and Willis were there, too. They stopped talking when they saw me. I tried to look as defeated as I felt. My mother teared up, shook her head, and went upstairs without so much as a hello.
Mom?
I called after her. She didn't look back. Not once. It hurt. Worse than I could have imagined. And had I known that this was the last time I'd ever see her, I would have forced her to turn around and race back to me, to hug me, to say something. That moment, and the look of my mother wholly disappointed in her son, still haunts me to this day. There I go, getting ahead of myself again. You'll understand soon enough. Officer Ramirez held out a pair of handcuffs for me.
Nothing personal, Hutch.
I know, Ram Jam, I replied, holding out my hands without protest. His face was grim. As soon as the cuffs were on, he steered me to the car.
Let's get this over with, he said.
After booking, they brought me to the juvenile detention section of the building. It was an area I knew all too well. It was practically a second home. I reckon I'd spent more time in juvie than school at this point. I'd stayed silent the whole ride there and throughout the booking process, not to exercise my right to remain silent, but to keep my emotions in check. It sort of worked until now. You take care of yourself, Officer Willis told me once he dropped me off in my personal holding cell. He gave me a friendly nod before walking off. I grunted in response. A few minutes later, Officer Ramirez stopped in to check on me. I know he believed in me and had higher expectations of me than I did. He and Officer Willis commonly referred to me as the dumbest smart kid they knew. They tried to convince me that I could probably get a full academic ride to most colleges if I only applied myself. It had never occurred to either of them that I didn't have the money to take SAT prep classes. I was out in the real world, where my experiences happened to be sharpening my skills as a baby criminal. A life of crime wasn't my first choice, but it was what this life seemed to have in store for me. Hell, maybe I'd get to see my dad. No doubt he was on the officers' minds, too. With me in here, he was definitely on my mom's. When I was 8, my dad had been sentenced to 20 years at the Huntsville State Pen for drug smuggling. It was a raw deal. A friend of his had been trying to pay off a loan my dad had given him for a car with 200 pounds of pot instead of cash when the cops showed up and busted both of them. My dad had been labeled a drug kingpin, and his arrest had been the cornerstone of a local sheriff's re-election. The shock and humiliation of it all had destroyed my mother. I'd had to grow up in a hurry after that and do what I could to help make ends meet. A long and winding road had led me here. Now I was fully alone with my thoughts and wished my brain had a sleep mode. Depending on what they charged me with, I was looking at anything from a slap on the wrist to, who knows, years? I had managed to hold my emotions back and fight them off, but I finally lost the battle and teared up. I may have acted and seemed older, but I was still only 14. Alone, I allowed myself to drop my guard and loosen my armor. I dreamed of getting out of this town, of making something for myself. Now I was trapped in a cage. I wish I could say it was a metaphor, but it wasn't. And I'm also not entirely sure what metaphor is. So I sang. Deck my cell with bars so gnarly, fa-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la. It's my life, come join the party, fa-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la. This sucks. Chapter 3. Peace Out. The judge I got had zero sense of humor, absolutely none, and sentenced me to 9 months in juvie. It would have been the longest stretch of time I'd ever seen. Would have seen. A few weeks into my stay, while in biology, yes, you still have to go to school in juvie, the clicking of heels coming down the hallway announced the arrival of an unknown guest.
Do you have Robert Hutchinson back there?
A woman was talking to the guard outside the classroom door. Her voice was crisp, authoritative. Hearing my name woke me up a bit. I had zoned out since the teacher had started talking about genetics. I didn't get it, and I didn't understand how it would help me in life, given I wasn't going to be a scientist. Look at who you're talking to, dude. Do we look like the future doctor types?
Maybe,
the guard responded. By the tone of his voice, I could tell she wasn't someone he knew. Yes, this was a prison, but this was our prison. We were sort of a dysfunctional family in that we all distrusted outsiders.
Bring him to interview room D, please, the woman replied.
There was a pause. Suddenly, the officer stammered.
Yes, ma'am, right away, ma'am, room D.
Officer Limpy, overweight and limping, appeared at the door. Yeah, we called him Limpy because he had a bad hip. We were uncreative, terrible, horrible, no good delinquents, remember? He didn't know we called him that, of course.
Let's go, Hutch. On your feet, he commanded.
I stayed in my chair. Who wants to see me?
On your feet, Hutch. Let's go,
Limpy ordered, seriously. I looked around the room. All eyes were on me. For the briefest of moments, I thought about refusing to move, but all that would do was buy me a good manhandling. If I'd needed to up my cred, it would have been worth it. But I had plenty of cred here. The long-termers knew me and we were cool, and any fish looking to make a name for themselves took one look at my size and thought otherwise. No, if I cooperated, it might help me later on. This place ran on favors. I got up and followed him out into the dull gray hallway. I knew it wasn't my mother. Was it my lawyer, maybe? Seemed out of character for a court-appointed lawyer to come visit. They represent you, get the verdict, and move on. This was not my first rodeo. I knew the routine. Then the panic hit. Oh, no. They had found out about... No. No way. Never. But... Who wants to see me? I tried asking as Limpy led me down the hallway.
Does it matter?
Limpy responded. I think so. Am I in trouble?
You're here, aren't you?
Who wants to see me? I repeated.
No more questions.
Come on, man, who—
Silence, inmate,
Limpy said with menacing finality. He even went so far as to reach for his baton. Okay, chill out. I waited a few moments before saying, you know, I've been working on a new one. Want to hear it? A faint smile crossed his face. He rolled his eyes and his hand dropped away from the baton.
Sure, kid.
Still a little rough, work in progress, so, you know. Okay. I took a deep breath.
On the first day of Christmas, the Popo gave to me 9 months of life in juvie.
Limpy's smile reappeared.
On the second day of Christmas, the Popo gave to me 2 pairs of slip-ons and 9 months of life in juvie. On the third day of Christmas, the Popo gave to me 3 squares a day, 2 pairs of slip-ons, and 9 months of life in juvie.
I stopped singing and shrugged. That's where I'm stuck. Got any ideas for 4? I asked him.
I'm not that creative, kid. That's your department.
He turned and led me around a corner to a blue metal door painted with a white block letter D. Limpy knocked. There wasn't an answer. He pushed the door open. The room was empty.
In,
he instructed. Then he slammed the door behind me. The room was sad and barren, except for a rectangular table. It was lit by a single gloomy light in the middle of the ceiling. 2 chairs sat on either side of the table. One normal, the other with places to shackle someone. Pretty obvious where I was supposed to sit, but I just paced and worked on my newest jingle.
On the fourth day of Christmas, the Popo gave to me 4 daily beatings.
No.
4 minute showers.
No.
4 hours yard time. 5 bathroom breaks.
I started laughing. I used to crack myself up. Sometimes. The laughter stopped when the door opened. In walked a stocky 30-something woman. She had on a snug, off-the-rack navy pantsuit, and her thick, curly black hair was pulled back into a loose ponytail. Strands of it had come free and poked up around her head.
Please have a seat,
the woman said politely, shutting the door again. I sat across from her, confused. She had a sparkle in her eye. Maybe even a small smile. It was a bit off-putting, to be honest. I hadn't seen a look like that since I'd been inside.
Robert Hutchinson?
I nodded.
And you like to sing?
I shrugged. Helps pass the time as good as anything.
You're not bad.
I shrugged again. Okay. What was the point of all this?
You only do goofy holiday songs or you take requests?
Both. Whatever.
It embarrasses you?
No. She reached into her pocket and pulled out what looked like a small tape recorder.
Watch this,
she said, nodding at the camera in the upper corner of the ceiling. A red power light was glowing underneath it. She pushed a button on the side of the small tape recorder device. The device began to hum quietly, and at the same time, the red light on the camera flipped off.
Scrambler,
she said with a wink. She pocketed it as she continued.
Just in case, don't want anyone watching or listening.
Because? I began, but really my mind was more focused on how I could steal that scrambler from her and sell it.
Because the people in charge here don't need to know what we're going to talk about.
What are we going to talk about?
What indeed?
She replied playfully. Are you my lawyer?
Heavens no, do I look like a lawyer?
I shrugged. The cheap suit, the hair, I didn't want to offend her. Yeah, sorta. The woman waved me off.
Leslie Tanner,
she said, standing up to shake my hand. I stood up and took it. She had a grip like a vice. I winced and she let go. Having completed the formal adult-style introductions, Leslie sat back down. I did too. If you're not my lawyer, then why are you here? I asked, massaging my fingers under the table.
I'm here on behalf of the government.
City?
The secret kind.
There was a hefty silence. Okay, so is this like where you tell me I was genetically made in a CIA lab and I'm sort of like a super spy? I asked snidely.
No, and I'm not with the CIA, she said. I'm from an agency you've never heard of, and I'm here because you die tomorrow.
She didn't even blink. Her smile was gone. I wasn't sure how to react. Was all I could muster as I stared at her for a few seconds, waiting for her to break character and laugh. Is this a joke? It is, isn't it? I asked, grinning. They put you up to this. I fully expected Limpy or another officer to burst in. Like I said, we had our differences in here, but we could still have some fun with each other. Something like this was pretty elaborate, but I wouldn't have put it past them.
I promise you, this is not a joke.
Not a hint of a smirk, smile, or grin. Hell of a poker face on this one. Right, I answered.
What if I told you that tomorrow a young boy trying to prove his toughness to a gang will stab and kill you?
Bummer? Oh, but then I'd remember that no one can see the future and ask if you'd forgotten to take your anti-crazy pills this morning. Again, no response. This wasn't even a good lie. How much longer would they keep this going? If you can see the future, what am I about to do next? I asked. She shook her head.
I can't see the future, not like that.
Not like that? So you're admitting you can in some other way? She sighed and shrugged. Then she muttered as if to someone else.
This is why I don't have kids.
Hey, you'd be lucky to have a kid like me.
Really?
I'm an acquired taste, I admitted.
Right,
she said, mimicking me from earlier. Now I was pissed. Look, no offense, Leslie, but I don't know you. I've had more realistic conversations with drunk hobos at 2 a.m. than I'm having with you. She shrugged again and said,
I told them this wouldn't work and that they should just do the extraction like always, but no.
Them? Extraction? She either didn't hear me or ignored me.
Look, I read your file. I know you have trust issues.
She pulled out a light blue folder from a leather carrier bag on the floor, then flipped it open. Lo and behold, my picture was looking up.
But generally, I liked what I saw in here, trust issues aside, of course.
Of course, I echoed.
You're rebellious, but not without cause. You're intelligent, charming, athletic, but above all else, when you see something wrong, you try to stop it. You don't look around for someone else to do it or simply move on, shaking your head. You act, which very, very few do. It's a trait we hold in high regard, and we want you to come work for us.
The file was an interesting development, but I still didn't buy this story. If it was a prank, though, it was pretty damn elaborate. Work for you? At the crazy farm? I asked.
All right, kid.
She snapped. She shoved the file back into her bag.
I'm tired, I'm hungry, I'm sweaty, and this is going nowhere fast. I'm leaving. You coming with me, or what?
Or what? I snapped back. I was tired, too.
The alternative is that I beat the piss out of you for being a stubborn, stupid child and drag you out of here by your disgusting, greasy hair.
Now that was a threat, and the way she stared at me made me believe she was serious about doing it.
Try me,
she added menacingly. Where had fun Leslie gone? I wanted to call her bluff, but something about her made me rethink it. Gone was the cheery, I can see the future crazy lady. Now a suddenly dangerous woman sat across from me.
Come with me right now, and all of this goes away.
She flashed a badge of some kind, but the motion was too quick for me to read it.
This means no one will stop us.
Then I'm in, I said. At least I'd get an answer. Oh, you're certifiable, But I'd follow the Hamburglar out of here if he could set me free. I stood up and asked, "So we're just gonna walk out of here and into the sunset now?"
"Like Butch and Sundance."
"Butch and who?" She stood too and shook her head.
"Your generation depresses me," she said sadly. "Come on."
She moved past me and walked out of the room. I followed but hesitated at the door. Limpy was long gone. The hall was deserted. Was this really happening? Was I actually buying into this? When Leslie reached the intersection down the hall, she paused and looked back at me.
"Let's move, Hutch," she barked.
My heart began to pound as I followed her. We strode through the prison like we owned the place. Or she did. I only followed her lead. Around every corner, I fully expected to run into a group of guards laughing hysterically, but never did. We never even slowed down. Every locked door buzzed and swung open for us in advance. All eyes turned away as we passed. Nobody tried to stop us. When I passed my prison-appointed therapist, he waved at me. I had to ask, "Is this a joke?" He exhaled. "Hutch, whoever that lady is, become her friend. She's got some serious connections." "For real?"
"Hutch,"
Leslie cried out before my therapist could answer.
"Move it."
"I would get moving," my therapist offered. "That your professional opinion?" I joked. "Stay out of trouble, Hutch," he said with a wry smile, knowing full well that would never happen. Before I knew it, we were through the visitors' area and headed straight for the exit. I paused. This was really happening. What was going on? "What about my stuff?" I asked, remembering my clothes, wallet, keys, and phone that they tossed in a bag when I got here. "You were supposed to get those things back when you left."
"Won't need them,"
she called from outside. I hurried through the final door. The prison had a yard, and I got to spend a couple hours out there every day, but there's something about free air that tastes better. I took a deep breath. "Now what?" I asked. Out of the corner of my eyes, I saw something rapidly approaching down the driveway. A van with darkened windows screeched to a halt in front of us. The door swung open.
"Now comes the fun part," she said, grinning.
In a move faster than I thought possible, Leslie reached out and used that crazy, strong, vice-like grip of hers to snag my right wrist. I jerked my arm. I was big enough and strong enough that I should have been able to shake myself free, but her grip didn't give. It somehow got tighter. She took a quick step toward me. An instant later, I was soaring through the air over her hip. I landed hard on the concrete sidewalk. Before I could even say, "ow," her knee jabbed right into my ribcage, knocking the wind out of my lungs. Leslie grabbed my wrist again, folding it in half like origami. The pain was excruciating.
"Up,"
she instructed. My wrist felt like it would snap in half if I didn't obey. I looked around for help as she dragged me to my feet, but none was offered from the guards in the parking lot. What the hell, prison family? She shoved me into the van and the door was closed before I'd even crumpled to the floorboards, clutching my wrist. While I tried to catch my breath, I barely heard her shout out,
"Deputy U.S. Marshals, we're all good here."
U.S. Marshals? Was I being transferred? Seemed like a pretty rough way to do it. This was not protocol. This was not how the Marshals worked. I'd watched Justified, so I knew. This was something new and different. It was also pitch black and weirdly silent. When the van suddenly accelerated forward, I fell backward. When I regained my balance, I felt my way forward until I reached a solid metal wall. I banged on it as hard as I could.
"Hey, what's going on? Let me out of here."
Okay, I'll admit it. I was afraid now. My imagination wasn't too shabby, and I'd seen too many movies to believe this would end well. Look, I talked a big game, but I was still only 14, and this had gotten scary in a hurry. Luckily, before I could really panic, I heard a hiss, and the air unexpectedly smelled sweet like honey. My eyelids felt heavy, and my thoughts became slow. Mmm. Honey. Drizzle it on toast. It's sticky. Honey, I said with a smile. After that, I was out cold. Chapter 4. Definitely not juvie. allergy pills. That's how I felt. You know, like how you feel super sleepy after you take one of those allergy pills at night, but then have to wake up too early the next day. I wanted to go back to sleep, but there was some annoying repetitive beeping. It was accompanied by a definite cold breeze on my junk. I forced my eyes open. I was in, best I could guess, the middle of some kind of hospital patient room type place, strapped firmly to a chair by my arms and wrists, wearing only a hospital gown. That explained the breeze. Super. The smell of bleach was so strong it burned my nose. I'd been in these before, after a scuffle at juvie a couple years ago. I'd given those things hell back then and had gotten zilch out of it, except really sore wrists. No matter what you see in the movies, you ain't chewing, rocking, or pulling yourself out of true prison-issued restraints. Nope, I was stuck here until whatever was going to happen, happened. Might as well save my energy. I was scared. Who wouldn't be? But I was more curious than anything. This day, if it was even the same one, had taken one hell of a turn for the bizarre. If Leslie had wanted me dead, I would be, so that was comforting, I guess. She could have let me die in juvie like she claimed I would have, or killed me in the van. Why keep me alive if the plan was to kill me anyway? Made no sense, right? But there were some messed up people in this world, like Leslie. Any moment now, I'd pass the threshold between keeping cool and really freaking out. I was about to scream for answers when the door slid open. An old dude in a white lab coat came in. He totally looked like a real doctor, and for some reason that calmed my nerves. Maybe it was the glasses. "Good morning, mister." He peered down at a thin, paper-sized piece of square glass in his hand and tapped it. Instantly, the glass came to life, and a picture of me was staring up at him from it. I could see it from behind. My eyes widened, but he tapped the screen blank after he got my name and continued. "Hutchinson, how are we feeling?" It was a pretty stupid first question. Didn't he know I had just been busted out of prison, gassed, and then woken up here? "Tired?" I answered. "I will wear off soon enough," he told me. He took a seat on the round rolling stool next to me. I hadn't even noticed it until now. The door slid open again. In walked a petite, pretty cute redheaded girl. I was suddenly very aware of how near naked I was. "Get lost?" the man asked her. She was super pale. I mention this because when she went red with embarrassment, it looked almost fake. "Sorry," she answered, eyes down. "Don't be. Confusing place. We don't have the convenience of the lights to guide us around. Prepare the shot, please," he instructed. He turned back to me and rolled his eyes, adding under his breath, "New interns, right?" Interns? What the hell was this place? "Where am I?" I asked. "I guess you could call it home," he answered. "I never understood why they insist on doing this before explaining everything to you. Seems a bit cruel, like they get off on the fear or something. But I just work here." "I'm not afraid," I lied. "Good, you shouldn't be." "What's about to happen to me?" I asked, swallowing. I knew I couldn't move, but I struggled anyway. A reflex. Instinct. "I'm not going to kill you," he assured me. "Thanks?" The intern appeared at his side holding a metal tray with the biggest syringe I'd ever seen. Needles didn't bother me, but this thing was almost as big as a turkey baster. All my veins quivered in fear. "I'm all up to date on my vaccines, Doc." It was worth a try. The doctor smiled. "Cute." The syringe was filled with what looked like black paint. The doctor took it from the tray and held it up, then scrunched up his face. "You know what?" He put the syringe back on the tray and looked at the intern. "Why don't you do it?" He got up and patted his old seat. "I've never," she began. "Given anyone fire? First time for everything." "Never given someone a shot before," the intern finished. He waved her off. "He's a tough kid. You're a tough kid, right?" What was the right answer here? "Look at those muscles. He can handle it," he told her, patting his empty seat again. She sat down. For the first time, she looked at me. She'd been avoiding eye contact this whole time. She had pretty green eyes. Yes, they were worried and scared eyes, which concerned me, but they were pretty. The old man took a call and left the room without a word. It was just the two of us now. Now, I pride myself on being a tough guy. I can fake it, even when things get crazy. But if I have one weakness, it's a sad girl. It's the kryptonite to my Superman. I can't handle it. I'll do anything to cheer that girl up. Tears? Forget about it. I'll run through a brick wall to make them stop. The intern took the needle from the tray. I couldn't help but gulp as she looked down at my arm. Hey, I said quietly. When she didn't look up, I repeated. Hey. Her eyes flashed to mine. She was nervous. Just do it. I'll be fine. You're not trying to kill me, right? She shook her head. Then do it. No grudges. Promise. You know, assuming I live.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.